cover the nuts and bolts of the criminal law. We're going to cover the... We're going to gloss over what usually takes an entire semester to teach. First, what is a crime or what is not a crime? A crime has elements. And a traditional common law offense has seven elements. And we commonly know the term beyond a reasonable doubt. Each element must be proven beyond a reasonable doubt for a crime to have occurred. If an element is missing, no crime occurred. Even if it sounds like a crime, all seven elements must be proven beyond a reasonable doubt in our system of justice. The first one, mens rea, fancy Latin term, it means the evil mind. And what mens rea basically equates to in the criminal law is that the person intended to do the action that was criminal, is that they planned it, thought it, intended it. It was not an accident or a mistake. Actus reus is the evil act. And essentially, so this is the criminal mind and the criminal act, the single two most important parts of a crime, is that someone did the criminal act and someone intended to do the criminal act. The third element, concurrence, says that the actus reus and the mens rea must act as one, that they didn't work independently from one another. And we'll come back with some examples of this. Fourth, harm. There must have been some form of harm that resulted as a result of the crime. It could be very minor. It could be pinching someone. That could constitute an assault. But there must be some sort of harm, or at least attempted harm. Causation. Causation, that harm must have been caused by the act of the perpetrator. Legality, the act must have been made illegal prior to its commission, and something can't be illegal after its commission. And punishment is the crime, there must be a punishment. If there is no punishment, then there is no crime. A crime is punished in criminal law. So, mens rea is the evil mind. So, to give you an example of that, mens rea is to go out and to swing a baseball bat at somebody's head and to hit them. You had the intent to hit them, so you had the mens rea. But if you were, say, practicing your swing in the batter's box and somebody walked up behind you, and while you're practice swinging, you hit them in the head. Well, you have the criminal act because you hit somebody in the head with the bat, but you don't have the mens rea because you did not intend to hit them, so it would be an accident rather than a crime. If you intended to hit them in the head with the bat, then you would have had the mens rea, and it would have been a crime. But because you were sitting there swinging your bat, warming up, and you hit them in the head, it was an accident. So the actus reus, the evil act was present, but not the evil mind. With that, concurrence. How must the actus reus and the mens rea concur? The classic example I use is a bunch of kids are playing stickball out in the street, and old crab apple nasty grandpa comes out and says, you kids, get out of the street. You're making too much noise. And little Johnny, who was up at bat to get revenge, goes up and grabs a big rock and throws it at grandpa's window, and intending to break the window, not realizing on the other side of the window, grandpa was sitting in his armchair. The rock comes through the window and hits grandpa in the head, and he is killed. The actus reus is murder. But what is the mens rea? The mens rea was vandalism. So we run into a problem because the actus reus, the intent, was to vandalize the man's house by breaking his window, not to kill him. But the act was, well, the window was vandalized, but he was also killed. So you have an act that says murder, but mens rea that says vandalism. What do you do with that? The mind and the act do not concur. Well, then the concurrence element fails, because the mind and the act must concur. Harm. There must be some type of harm involved. Is that somebody must be harmed, and that harm must be caused by the criminal act. It can't be some other cause. So, for instance. Real case example, bar fight breaks out. Guy gets punched in the face, knocked unconscious. He's carted off to the hospital. Now, while in the hospital, he's just showing the ordinary symptoms of a drunk guy who got punched in the face. But he's unruly, so he's placed in restraint in the hospital bed. And he breaks out of the hospital bed, very unruly, and the side of his head smashes into a television, one of the elevated television sets. And he collapses. And all of a sudden, he's brought into emergency surgery. And they do the emergency surgery, and he's got severe head injuries, and he's crippled for life. Well, what started out as a simple assault, a simple barroom fight, has now turned into a serious aggravated assault with life-threatening injuries. So what would have been 6 months probation has now turned into a potentially 20-year prison sentence. But the question is causation. Was the injury caused by the guy who punched him? If we can't prove beyond a reasonable doubt that the injury that he received was caused by the punch, then we can't punish him for that. Is we have an intervening cause. We have the guy smashing his head into the television set. Now, did that cause? We don't know. But it's an alternative theory of causation. Legality simply says that that something must be made illegal before they do it. How can someone know? How can somebody have mens rea if something is not a crime when they do it? It's legal to do it when you do it, but now, later on, we've made it a crime. So something must be illegal at the time of the act. And then punishment. What distinguishes criminal crimes from torts? Punishment. Punishment, if there is no law, then there is no punishment. And if there is no punishment, then there is no law. If you violate the law, you must be punished. And those are the seven elements of a crime, of a common law crime. In the 19th century, as we talked earlier about urbanization, as urbanization increased, it became very difficult to prove mens rea for what we call public welfare offenses. So it became very difficult to prosecute people for simple offenses, and we created what are called strict liability offenses. And what strict liability means is that the mens rea element is removed, and it's much easier to prove that somebody did something than somebody intended to do something and did something. It makes criminal prosecution much easier. And where we see it today, strict liability most commonly, is in motor vehicle offenses. When you drive down the highway, if you get pulled over doing 85 and a 55, and you say to the trooper, well, my speedometer was broken, that's no defense. Now, if it was a mens rea-based offense, then it would be a defense because you didn't know you were speeding, so you didn't know what you were doing was wrong. But it's no defense at all because it's strict liability. And there's no mens rea in strict liability. All you have to do is prove that the act. The only question the law has is, were you driving 85 miles per hour? Were you driving 85 miles per hour and you knew it was wrong? The only question in strict liability is that you were driving 85 miles per hour, and it makes prosecution much, much easier. And we're going to see strict liability is in this class when we start talking about felony murder, we start talking about certain drug offenses, vicarious liability. Strict liability can become a major factor. There are also defenses to crimes. There are many defenses, but I put up the four most prevalent defenses. The first is insanity. We hear a lot about insanity. Oh, the people go insane. Is insanity essentially says, negates the mens rea element. His insanity says that somebody did not understand what they were doing was wrong. They could not appreciate the nature and the consequence of their actions. So to give you a very, very simple example, is your professor is crazy. And I am standing here teaching the class, and all of a sudden, a particular student I look at is about to assassinate the president or explode an atomic bomb in the classroom. And I pull out my firearm in an attempt to save the country.